Hey, Grio fam, it's Gerren Keith Gaynor, managing editor of politics and Washington correspondent at theGrio. And I am here with someone who needs no introduction. She is the Democratic nominee for governor in Georgia, Ms. Stacey Abrams. Welcome to theGrio. It's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you for having me.
This November, you are taking a second shot at becoming the next governor of Georgia and potentially the first Black woman governor in the entire history of the United States. What is something that you learned from your 2018 campaign that you are taking into account in this year's election cycle?
That this is absolutely winnable. When our communities stand up, when we believe that we are entitled to more, when we vote our power, we actually can change the outcome of elections. While I did not win in 2018, we had the single highest voter turnout for any Democrat in the history of the state of Georgia. And we were able to build on that in 2020 for Joe Biden and in 2021 for Raphael Warnock and John Ossoff. But it was 2018 that really demonstrated how extraordinarily powerful our voters are. But for years, we'd become convinced that we didn't have the ability to change outcomes. Now we know we do. And part of what I'm trying to leverage is reminding people of their power to shape the future.
And obviously, Black voters are incredibly crucial to the success of your campaign. What do Black Georgians stand to lose or gain in this gubernatorial race?
So let's set the frame. Under the next governor, whoever is elected on November 8th will be the governor when Georgia not only becomes a majority minority state, but when African Americans for the first time since Reconstruction become the majority of the minority. Meaning that our political power, our economic opportunity will never be as strong in the South as it will be under the next governor. My opponent has systematically disinvested from our communities. He has returned us to a path of mass incarceration. He presided over a COVID response that actually left most Black businesses outside of access to opportunity. Most Black businesses didn't get a dollar in PPP, but his company did, his friends got a $694 million contract, and yet Black businesses in Georgia only get 2.1% of the business revenue and less than 1% of state contracts as of the last number that we were able to see. His response is to just study and see if that's a problem. We know that we have seen healthcare challenges increase for our communities. We are the most likely to die from diabetes, from hypertension, from maternal mortality, and yet he refuses to expand Medicaid. And hundreds of Black people are going to lose access to a hospital in downtown Atlanta because he is refusing to expand Medicaid. The Atlanta Medical Center is going to shut down on November 1st, a month and a half before Christmas. Hundreds of Black and Brown folks are going to lose their jobs and people are going to lose their lives. That's what we have. If I'm the governor, we will have a governor who actually believes in investing in our children from cradle to career, fully funding education, paying our teachers a minimum of $50,000 a year, giving every educator an $11,000 increase, putting money into our businesses, making sure that Black-owned businesses get a fair share of contracts by not only making certain that we buy from, that the state buys from Black-owned businesses through what I'd like to call our commercial investment program, but that we also have cluster contracts so more Black-owned businesses can compete for those big dollars that are coming in through the Infrastructure Act and the Inflation Reduction Act. I want to make certain that our returning citizens can start their own businesses because it's difficult to get a job in Georgia. I'm going to expand Medicaid, making certain that 500,000 Georgians get access to healthcare. And we can do everything I'm suggesting without raising a dime in taxes. We've had national economists validate my plan, and they will tell you that this is not about wishful thinking. This is about math. We have a $5 billion surplus that the governor wants to give to the wealthiest Georgians, just as he has every single time. He gives tax breaks to the rich and pennies to the rest of us. I want to invest in all of us. And that's what's at stake in this next election.
You have been making significant outreach to Black male voters, a voting bloc that has expressed grievances with the Democratic Party in terms of speaking to their concerns and needs as a constituency. What have you been learning from Black men, hearing from Black men, and how can you win their support?
What I'm hearing is what I hear from so many, People want to be seen. They want to be heard. They want to know that you understand their issues and their pain. And what I did in 18, what I'm continuing in 2022 is not new. I believe in having conversations with communities, and Black men in particular have been left out of conversations. And so in 2020, I did this. And in 2022, we are stepping it up because I understand the power of Black men to participate in our elections. But I also understand that their grievance is with politics writ large, that this is often not a conversation of whether they're going to choose me or my opponent. It's whether they feel that they should participate at all. And my responsibility is to articulate a plan that says, this is how we win. That's why we've published our Black Men's Agenda. And that's why we've been having these conversations to, one, signify that I see and hear the concerns, whether it's the over-disciplining of our young Black boys in our public school system, whether it's the fact that so many of our young people, if they finish high school, are basically told there's no more future because they can't get apprenticeships or get jobs. I want to create 20,000 apprenticeships. I want to make technical college free because that's the best way to get skills training for so many of our young people. And I want to create need-based financial aid because in Georgia, Black students are the least likely to get access to the merit-based aid that we have, and they're the most likely to lose it. But if we expand access to need-based aid, our students can not only go to college, they can finish college. I want to create an opportunity for a small business investment fund so more of our Black-owned businesses can get access to capital. And I want to make certain that we are buying from Black businesses. Those are all things that Black men want, but what they want is also good for the Black community and for Georgia. Black people are 33% of Georgia's population, and yet we are less than 2% of our business revenue. Black men deserve to have the same opportunities that we saw happen for Atlanta under Maynard Jackson. And my mission is to be the Maynard Jackson for the state of Georgia.
You have been the face of voter protection, voter expansion. Many credit you for President Biden's win in Georgia in the 2020 presidential election. Georgia is seen as ground zero for voter suppression after your opponent, Governor Kemp, signed SB 202 into law. And many advocates, including yourself, have expressed grievances over that bill and its restriction targeting Black and brown voters. Are you concerned that these voting laws in Georgia stand to be roadblocks for Black and brown voters this November?
We know they're going to absolutely present obstacles, but what we're working to do is help people navigate those obstacles. We know that 1.9 million voters will have limited access to drop boxes. Drop boxes aren't just a nice to have. They were necessary because we have so many people working on call schedules who can't get to the drop boxes between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. That's why it was such a game changer to have them situated outside and available 24 hours a day. I use them to drop off my parents' ballots. And we need to make certain that the next governor restores access. But right now they're being restricted. We know that the absentee ballot process, because they made it more difficult, we know that there are senior citizens, especially Black seniors, who for 15 years could expect their absentee ballot to arrive in the mail. But because they changed the rules, if these voters didn't vote in the primary because neither Senator Warnock nor I had competition, they may not get their ballots because it's not going to show up automatically. They now have to reapply. Imagine being 90 years old, having voted the same way for 15 years, and you've now been told or not told that your ballot's not going to show up, and now the window for getting access is even more limited. We know that for the disabled, and for that, we have a number of people of color who are in the disability community, especially Black people, who are now limited in how they can cast their ballots. But what we also know is that when we turn out in record numbers, when we overwhelm the system with our presence, that is how we win. That's why we are going to push hard for people to vote early in person. The earlier we vote, the harder it is for them to block us. The later we wait, the more dangerous the obstacles become, and they move from being obstacles into indeed being roadblocks. But we want them to be obstacles we can navigate, not roadblocks that stop our voices from being heard. And that's why our campaign is going to be pushing for people to make a plan to vote, make a plan to vote early, and show America what Georgia can do.
And in terms of voter excitement or lack thereof, in the 2020 election, it was without a doubt, we saw amazing turnout from Black and brown voters during a pandemic, no less. One could argue that a lot of the 2020 election was a referendum on the Trump presidency. Now that Trump is no longer on the ballot, are you concerned that there's less of a turnout that will happen this year in this year's election because Trump is no longer on the ballot?
Well, we know midterm elections tend to draw a smaller crowd than presidential elections. Presidential elections spend billions of dollars on the same conversation across 50 states. You're always going to have fewer people who show up in a midterm, but that doesn't speak to energy. It just speaks to numbers. We expect there to be about 4 to 4.5 million voters, which is a high number of voters because Georgia has been demonstrating more and more high volume voting. But what we also know is that while I appreciate the plaudits that I've received, we didn't do this alone. I didn't do this alone. We came together and said that the future that we wanted could not include someone who didn't value our humanity, value our citizenship, value our democracy. We've got to do the same at the state level because it's the governor who decides whether or not our children face gun violence in their schools. It's the governor who decides whether we have bodily autonomy as women. It's the governor who will spend $5 billion either investing in our communities, which is what I want to do, or giving that money to the wealthiest Georgians, which is what he wants to do. It will be the governor who decides whether our voting rights actually remain our rights. We have watched Brian Kemp over the last 12 years systematically disenfranchise voters. He didn't stop just because he didn't commit treason when Trump asked him to change the outcome of the election. He simply did what every other governor in America did. But we cannot forget who he was before he ran, who he was when he sued to stop the mayor of Atlanta and the mayor of Savannah from protecting their people, who he is when he allows a hospital to shut down in the heart of Atlanta because he is too mean to accept the money. And so my mission is to use all of these proof points to remind Georgians that we are responsible for our own destiny. Yes, the energy of 2020 was palpable, but so was the existential crisis. We are facing a new crisis, but we need people to understand that it is our opportunity and our obligation to respond. We have to generate our own excitement, and I know we can get that done.
There is a perception among Democrats and strategists based on some of the Democratic wins we've been seeing in this primary election season in competitive districts that that Republican bans on abortion, post-Supreme Court, their ruling on the Dobbs case that overturned Roe v. Wade, that it will deliver victories for Democrats in November. Your opponent, Governor Kemp, signed such an abortion law that bans abortion after six weeks. You have been a supporter of abortion rights. You've been candid about your evolution on the issue. What impact do you believe the issue of abortion will have in the Georgia elections this year?
I believe it is a galvanizing force, but it is not a guarantee. We have to remember that for so many in the South, We've become numb to having our rights stripped away. We've become inured to how little the Republican Party cares about our needs. But we have the opportunity in this election to transform the outcome by pushing back against this egregious attack on our bodily autonomy. Women deserve reproductive care, but especially Black women. As someone who suffered from fibroids myself, I've had to rely on reproductive care simply to keep me functional. And we know that because of this law, there are doctors and there are pharmacists who are denying women access to basic reproductive care because they are afraid, because they think that their conscience demands that they interfere with our bodily autonomy. We know that Black women are 3 times more likely to die in childbirth or after in the state of Georgia, that we are number one for maternal mortality, both overall and for Black women. That gets worse because of Brian Kemp. We know that we have 82 counties without an OBGYN, 64 counties without a surgeon, 18 counties without a family doctor, 9 counties without a doctor at all. And Black women live in every one of those places and are being denied access to basic health care. We also know that 1 in 5 women is denied insurance right now because Brian Kemp won't expand Medicaid. And if you don't have the insurance you need to take care of yourself before you get pregnant, pregnancy becomes dangerous. We know that Black women, like all women in Georgia, are now subject to investigation for miscarriages and might be forced to wait for an ectopic pregnancy to rupture. We know that victims of sexual assault are being told you have to report your the crime against your body. You have to be re-traumatized before you can make a decision about how you address that issue. And that includes victims of human trafficking who don't have the ability to take themselves to a police station. Brian Kemp has made it dangerous to be a woman in Georgia. And while I do think it should be a galvanizing issue, we cannot just assume it happens. We've got to work to animate every single voter. And I know that's what our campaign is doing. And I believe that's what we can do across the state.
And last question for you, Leader Abrams. As you know, in Georgia, if a candidate does not win 50% of the vote or more, the race heads to a runoff in December. How prepared are you for that outcome? And what is your final message to Georgia voters as they make their decision the final weeks before Election Day?
I'm in this to win. I would love to win on the first ballot. I think we have the numbers. 1.6 million people have been added to the rolls since the last contest in 2018. Of that, 53% are Democratic-leaning voters, meaning that if they vote, we win. But I also know that people are exhausted. We've been in a perpetual election since 2016. COVID has hit our communities hard. The economic anxiety that people feel is real. But what I want folks to understand is that whether it is on Election Day or on runoff day, we have to be in this to win. The urgency isn't going to come from outside. It's got to be built here. And that is because we actually deserve more. We have the money, we have the opportunity, and now we need the leadership. I am running because I know how to do this job. And the reason we've seen success over the last few years in Georgia is that we believed in our power to write our own story. I am running because I want us to write the next best chapter for Georgia. But that means every single voter who's waiting for the invitation, waiting for the reason to do so, to hear me now. And this is how I'll close. Stand Your Ground never had a single federal law. It was a state law passed by a governor. The erosion of the social safety net didn't happen in Washington. It started with the governor of Wisconsin. Mass incarceration didn't start with a 94 crime bill. It started with Governor Pete Wilson in California. He did the three strikes you're outlaw. And Jim Crow never had a single federal law. It was 9 Southern governors who stripped Black people of their humanity for 150 years. Well, in less than 60 days, we have the opportunity to tell a brand new story, not only about Georgia, but about the South by electing me as the next governor. So I need folks to get energized, to get engaged, and to get out there and make sure you cast your ballot, because together we thrive.
Ms. Abrams, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.